So I'm going to run through some DCOS stuff and some ESOS stuff and Juju stuff. This is a talk that I recycled from ESOSCon last week in Amsterdam. So there's an awful lot of explanation stuff that you probably already know because you've been here for a day, but I sort of left it so you can just go through it. So it was written to explain Juju stuff to people who didn't really know Juju. Anyway, I was here yesterday, so you all know who I am. In my previous life, I'm a business intelligence consultant. And so we deal a lot with data processing, big data type stuff. Streaming data, all that type of stuff. And occasionally do some open source development. So this is my little story about my work at Meteorite and the challenges we face in a small development business intelligence shop when it comes to hosting, developing, extending our own services. And so I guess it best starts with a very basic Google drawing picture, which sort of explains how the server works internally. When we had three boxes, two of them were official, one was just because I liked hacking and I couldn't be asked to do it on the proper boxes. And so we'd have customer-facing stuff. You know, customer-facing stuff, you don't want it to fall over. Probably don't want to hack around with it too much because you break stuff. Development server for all the developers, building things, testing stuff, running CI jobs, Maven repos, shell services, Docker images, you can just use to chuck stuff at it. And so we had three independent or more independent servers, all running their own stuff, different versions, version control, absolutely no control over what we're deploying into our own environment. Which I guess is probably pretty usual for startups. So as a startup, we were enrolled onto a program hosted by Big Step. Big Step are bare metal cloud provider and type setup. And so, we wanted to keep our existing platform running on Big Step setup because we get subsidized hardware, which is a bad thing. We also wanted to retain control of what we're trying to do with hardware costs, scaling, networking, all that type of stuff, but Big Step sort of do that. So we sort of mocked up, that was a really bad Google drawing, a sort of schematic diagram of what we were trying to offer to people, what we had internally that we needed to be able to have users run, and the priority of these things that are running. We want websites to react quickly, we want databases to react quickly, but we don't really care if a developer is running some, maybe build in a developer container, if it takes an extra 10 minutes, well, it's not the end of the world, they can just go out and look at it. We also wanted to be able to run our services in different data centers. We don't want to be locked down to either AWS or putting stuff in specific places. We wanted that resilience and data locality. And so we looked at different options that would allow us to achieve our goals. And so there's a few of them these days. We were looking for Docker-based solutions or container-based solutions because outside of me, our guys aren't particularly prolific in Java writing yet. So we're working on different things, but everyone knows how to write a doc file. Doc files are easy to get them and basically write, but you extend them and break them, it's a bit different. So there's a bunch of different options. We've got Docker Swarm. Docker Swarm will allow us to have an underlying subset of hardware, and you can chuck Docker containers at it, and it will go and put them in the right place. Kubernetes, Mesos, CoreOS, DCOS. Or of course, you can just do, Docker pull, Docker run onto fixed hosts themselves. But I come from the BI world, and I'm a bit of a sucker for a nice little dashboard. Clearly, it doesn't add any value to the actual platform. But it's an easy way to be able to sell stuff to people. You can sell a dashboard like this to non-technical people. They can look at it, they can understand what it does, and at a glance they can see what service is deployed internally, rather than showing the terminal. They get bored of terminals. So, we have a bunch of big step bare metal servers, so what's the most flexible way to manage them? So this is where we get into the stuff that's probably very obvious to a lot of you now, but we're all going through it quickly. MaaS, metal as a service. You know, metal as a service will allow you to take this bundle of servers and then start deploying workloads onto them. So, you know, those of you who haven't been in that room, MaaS will give you a nice looking web interface that allows you to configure the HTTP, different subnets, the networking, the images that get deployed onto these boxes, and you know, a bunch of different bits and pieces when it comes to doing this stuff up. I stole these off Google, by the way, so it, you know, when you say that's not your stuff, you're right, it's not my stuff. But you know, MaaS dashboard. So, you know, over the last 12 months, we've already migrated a bunch of our stuff over to Juju-based deployment. It made life easy for us, even though Big Step doesn't have a cloud provider plugin, you know, we can do manual deployment and that stuff. And for testing of our applications and installing new stuff and scaling, it's working pretty well. So, you know, could we make DCOS, as I was saying, for a nice dashboard, work with Juju? So, you know, application modeling with Juju, we've been through this. So, key concept, you know, the whole point of Juju is the ability to be able to deploy this stuff time and time again in a bunch of different places. And, you know, if we decided that Big Step was the way to go, and we're going to go somewhere else, we can rip it all down, we can go and check it with a different cloud provider, different methods of service setup, you know, and it would still work. So, Juju deploy DCOS. For those of you who haven't, like, got, in depth with Juju stuff yet, I'm not sure you've been doing it for the last day and a half. You know, Juju deploy DCOS master, DCOS agent, we have two nodes up and running. We can then relate these nodes together. So the relations allow the metadata to flow over the wire. It makes the master aware of the agent that's kicking around somewhere else in the network. And similarly, the agent can obviously tell the master that it's alive and kicking. It will allow us to scale. So, you know, as load increases on websites or services, we need more compute power. You know, we can chuck more agent nodes at the cluster, and they'll start spinning up, and we'll have more compute power. So, those of you who haven't come in contact with DCOS and some of the platforms, you know, the idea is it gives you the ability to just turn your entire computer to a single item, a single object. And so you can just start checking Docker containers at it, and it will load balance and scale as you configure it correctly and design it correctly, allowing you to not have to worry about placement of servers and all that type of stuff. So, you know, we can start spinning up more compute and put more Docker instances on there, and it will allow you to keep going. We can repeat it. We can export that stuff to a YAML file, and we can import it somewhere else. You know, it always deploys the same. And I don't proclaim to be the most knowledgeable Charm developer, the most knowledgeable DCOS person, the most knowledgeable Docker or container guy. But you know, I know that if I chuck these charms into the Charm store, you know, I can get like Chuck and the other guys to like at least cast their eye over and tell me where I've gone badly wrong. You know, and so it allows me to iterate and improve those charms. And if people use them and decide that they've got requirements for other stuff, they can obviously chuck pull requests in. And so, you know, someone comes along and says, oh, I need some extended logging, pull request goes in. I accept the pull request, I merge it in, I can deploy it to the charm store, charm gets extended logging. Better monitoring, we're working on that not too long ago, they're getting your nuggets, it's working properly, that type of stuff. You know, so being able to build these charms and put them into somewhere like a charm store obviously allows people to iterate over what's there. I haven't got an unlimited amount of time, so you know, having other people be able to do this obviously just makes life a lot easier as well. So we can chuck monitoring into the charms. So who here sets up Nagios pretty regularly? Yeah, there are some people in the back. Okay, so Nagios is one of the stalwarts of open source monitoring solutions. And whilst it's not overly complex, finding out the right way to put the hooks into the config files, making sure they all line up and then name the right thing and so on is a pain in the balls. You get it wrong, you'll restart. You'll get it wrong again, you'll restart. Until eventually it all starts working and you like to agree, or you realize your service is down and then turn red. But, you know, so the idea with Juju is the ability for us to be able to deploy this stuff time and time again, and also allow us to hook up to services that I can't be asked configuring. You know, so I want to deploy some monitoring. So Juju deploy Nagos, add in the monitoring stuff, and it will wait. And my DCS charm has some hooks that make Nagos understand what it's got to put where. And Nagos says, hey, I'm here, and the communication goes on, and suddenly I have a bunch of lights in my Nagos dashboard that tell me the health of all the services that bring in my DCS cluster. That's taken me about 10 lines of code, and I never have to write it again. Logging, you know, we can add logging to DCS. So, you know, these guys are here written them. You know, the beach charms, and so there's all the extended logging and stuff that comes with that. And so DCOS has logstash capabilities, and so I know that I can write a couple of relations and I can start logging all this stuff directly from the platform. Again, I have no idea how to set logstash, I have no idea how to scale logstash, I know roughly what Elasticsearch is, I don't know if I will allow me to search this stuff, you know. And I'm not bothered writing that type of stuff because Chuck up there does it. You know, and finally, when it comes to deploying containers, so you don't necessarily have to say, okay, well, I've got my systems up and running. And at that point, say, I'm just going to go back to the shell or whatever and start using that. You know, we wrote a hook that allows us to deploy Docker containers again through the model. So all we have to do is deploy our Charmer Docker container to the GUI, relate those two, create a JSON file, dump it on the server, tell the server to ingest it, and then 5 minutes later, our Docker containers are running. Now, there's something that's very useful about that. You know, the fact that those Docker containers stay within the model means that you can enrich the container itself in the metadata that Juju provides. You know, Juju is like a metadata transport platform. It just tells services about different bits of services. And so, you know, you can deploy a Docker container, and if it's got the right interfaces because you've charmed it up, you can say, okay, well, I want to front that with a non-dockerized HAProxy, or I want to connect that to a non-dockerized MySQL, because outside of Docker, I get better performance, or whatever. You know, it's co-located somewhere else. And so you can still use those hooks and interfaces inside your container and outside to provide that information going across the wire. So I should probably actually, because I have one running, I spent the morning happy around. So hopefully we can see that. So I should probably give you a quick little window of DCOS. This is my DCOS 101, but you know, you can see my dashboard here. So I did a separate dashboard. So it will tell me how many CPUs I have. So I've got a couple of compute nodes running in the back, so they're attached, and it says, you know, what the two shares. How much RAM's available? Obviously, depending on what services I deploy, that will change. As I add more services or tasks, that can fluctuate up or down. If stuff fails, it will tell me where the failures are. And, you know, as I scroll down, more stuff, but like, you know, I, in this demo, chucked Jenkins in. Marathon is there to run Docker containers, it's got a task running, and my stuff is healthy. You know, that type of stuff, when you don't have much bandwidth in terms of DevOps and type stuff, you know, allows me to see at a glance exactly what state of load the entire system's in. You know, and if nodes go down, I can see it down there. You know, if my node count is down or my RAM's up high, I need to start adding more stuff. You know, I do Juju add unit dash N 5 whatever, and I get 5 more agents up and running. They connect themselves, and it just doesn't sync. Again, you know, I can look at the CPU allocation. I can see down here exactly what's taking up. You know, my service is down here, and it's telling me, you know, what is being used. And then, I guess one of the more useful aspects of DCOS is it has a like package management. So, if that works, it's concrete blocks of wire. There's a bunch, not too dissimilar to Juju and the various channels behind it. There's a bunch of existing packages that I can click, and I can click install Jenkins or add me a spark node or whatever. And I'm going to deploy those. And so, you know, I chucked a Jenkins thing at it, it spun it up. I've not run a single line of code, written a single line of code. You know, it's given me a working Jenkins. Now, that's a very simple demonstration. Then you can start spinning room, Docker, bits and pieces, what have you. You know, so Marathon is the platform that provides containerization. This isn't called DCOS, this is part of the Mesos ecosystem as a whole. And so, you know, it will tell you what containers you have deployed, configuration, logging, all that type of stuff. So, you know, I now have a very powerful platform that allows me to look at all these containers that I have running on my system and maintain, you know, an overview of them without actually having to delve into the depths and start hacking around the code. And again, like I said back at the start, if you have non-technical users in your organization, your CIO might not actually have much knowledge of containers. Your CTO might not care particularly, but they would like to be able to see, you know, what's going on. And so something like this, dashboards like this, obviously just allow you to be able to demonstrate the state and the health of the system. Quick and easy. So, current state of play with these charms. So, you know, we've got master and client nodes that work and scale. In fact, we've already got one over on the DCOS guys because technically, if you deploy their stuff and masters go down, you can't scale them back up. But we sort of have that around to work. Monitoring connectivity, deploy Docker containers, a bunch of actions in the back end that allow you to programmatically deploy Docker containers and stuff like that. We have a big fat roadmap and more stuff. You know, we want to be able to implement NFS bounds, things like that, so you don't have to log into the charm and start running commands or scripts in there. Improve the monitoring, improve the security. There's some networking stuff we're opening out ports and bits and pieces. So, you know, there's still a bunch of stuff that we want to be able to do that just like gets rid of the script aspect of it. That's me, that's the community, that's also me. There's some bundles, you can find that stuff on GitHub. So, yeah, so that's DCOS. DCOS is great, but doesn't obviously fit everybody's needs. But I do like Mesos, I like what Mesos offers. And so maybe your organization doesn't want to use DCOS, but is interested in Mesos. So there's a couple of Mesos charms already in the charm store, but they're not layered. They don't use the new reactive framework, so I started this morning on sort of creating some new ones that will allow us to sort of leverage into the charm stuff. You know, DCOS, when you get it installed, because of the way they deal with their installation and configuration, it's pretty hard to change the underlying configuration once it's deployed. Like a one-shot menu, if you change it, you tear it back down and start it again. Which is pretty bad when it comes to Juju config and stuff like that. So, so we started on layered Mesos. So the idea being we have Mesos master and slaves, we have a Marathon charm that will be subordinate and install itself in the right place. We can reuse existing stuff that's in the charm store. You know, there's Zuki support, there's OpenJDK support. We can reuse existing charms without having to rewrite a whole bunch of stuff. We can start implementing stuff that doesn't work out of the box with DCOS, with SSL communication between the different interfaces, etc., etc. HA support and SDN in there as well. So, those of you who haven't seen the resource, so I started working on charm this morning. And this is like the Mesos dashboard. So it's not the same as the lovely DCOS one, but it will do the same stuff under the code. You know, so on the side you can see that I've got one agent up and running. That agent has 8 CPUs and 30 gigs in mem. That's a lie, that's because it's running in LexD. But you know, so you get the idea. So we can start spinning up more and more of these resource master and slaves. We can put the Marathon stuff in there. We can start running highly scalable Docker container stuff using those Mesos and the open source stuff. So, you know, there you go. That's a whirlwind of what we've been doing with DCOS and, you know, containerization stuff, and obviously trying to leverage what Juju already offers, you know, in a way that will make my life easier when it comes to deploying this stuff, the reusability easier for deploying this stuff, because I like open source stuff, so that means, you know, if I can give some charms back and people can use them and start spinning up their own DCOS or resource stuff, and that's great as well. So there you go. Now, you know, the containers are containers at the end of the day. And just in the same way that if you spin up a bunch of Docker containers using Docker Compose or something like that, there's networking between them, but they don't have the hooks that like deployment and Juju stuff would already, you know, offer you in on top of that. So in terms of the relationships, it's a bit different. But you know, the container stuff, especially for we find for remote development teams and stuff like that, containers work pretty well in a way that allows them to wrap their head around it, extend stuff, install things locally, that type of thing. So it works pretty well.
So it would mean that if you, for example, would install, I saw one of the services that you can put on DCOS as Spark.
Yeah.
If you would want to run like Python notebook,
yeah,
as a service, then there is no way to configure IPython to talk with that Spark instance, for example.
Not in a hookup box sense. Not in the way that if you deployed IPython in a jar, did it.
Yeah.
But I think there's work going on there to try and bring that type of stuff to, you know, the resource type of ecosystem. Because again, it makes sense, doesn't it? If you can do Juju Bootstrap, you know, to my resource ecosystem and deploy containers within it, then that makes sense. You just need to be able to run the next deep bit.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
I know Kubernetes, for example, has some very limited, like, service orchestration capabilities where it's mostly just pulling IP addresses.
Yeah, absolutely. So there's the networking aspect that does fully work. So you spin nodes up and you know what hostname is going to have and that type of stuff, and you can pre-configure IP addresses and stuff like that. But it doesn't get into the whole configuration, like you would populate a config files and stuff.
And have you ever messed around with, for example, trying to model the stuff that's running on DCOS in charms and then having charms change these containers to make the relationship?
Yeah, so that was sort of the thing I didn't go into in depth there, but yeah, so a couple of the charms that we've sort of like Docker containers we've charmed up. So like, obviously Docker containers, you can pass an environment variables and stuff like that. So you know, you can extend them far enough to accept like Juju based relationship hooks. It's